between auditory access and language access? Which one is more important for children's learning? Suppose the child didn't have any access to auditory information. Would that disrupt learning? Now suppose the child didn't have any access to linguistic information. Would that disrupt learning? That's the question we're after here. In this study, we focused on one particular kind of learning, known as implicit learning. You may think of that as unconscious learning or learning that happened without intention or awareness. That means that this kind of learning happens when we're not really trying to learn, we're not engaged or studying, we're simply going about life, and yet we acquire something even without realizing it. We may know it at an unconscious level, even if we don't know it at a conscious level. So that's implicit learning. And it plays critical roles in domains like language acquisition, motor skill development, and many others. Really, any time that we need to detect patterns or regularities in the environment. So that's implicit learning. So what's the problem? Well, one previous study proposed that if auditory information was absent, implicit learning would be impacted. And that decrease in implicit learning ability might help to explain why many deaf children struggle to acquire spoken language after cochlear implantation. This is known as the auditory scaffolding hypothesis. And if that hypothesis is correct, that suggests that all deaf children really need exposure to sound as young and as early as possible. And exposure to sign language, under that view, would not be predicted to help. But it's important to recognize that in that previous study, all of the participants involved didn't have any exposure to language prior to cochlear implantation. And maybe that lack of early access to language is what disrupted implicit learning. So we call this the language scaffolding hypothesis. And if that view is correct, that suggests that all deaf children really need exposure to language as young and as early as possible, and exposure to sign language is predicted to help in that case. There's also a third possibility. So in this previous study, their approach, their methodology, was very new and innovative, and it didn't use any of the more familiar, well-known, or commonly used tasks for measuring implicit learning. So it's important to check whether deaf children really have problems with implicit learning at all. The possibility exists that their skills may be fine. So that's the third possibility we're considering. So again, these three hypotheses: that auditory deprivation will disrupt implicit learning, that language deprivation will disrupt it, or that there will be no disruption. So how do we go about testing these three hypotheses? Well, we've taken a replicate and extend approach. In experiment 1A, we conducted a replication of that previous study using their same methodology. And in experiment 1B, we extended by adding a more well-known, familiar task called the serial reaction time task. In both experiments, there were three groups of participants. The first group was hearing children, ages 7 to 12. The second group was deaf children with hearing parents. They all received at least one cochlear implant before age 3, and they grew up without any sign language, using spoken language only. The third group was deaf children with deaf parents who grew up with exposure to sign language. So as for the results, well, we have these three hypotheses: auditory scaffolding, language scaffolding, and no disruption. The results supported this third possibility, that there was no disruption. In both experiments, participants in all three groups, the hearing children, the deaf children who use spoken language, and the deaf children who use sign language, they all looked the same. And that's good news. That means that implicit learning itself is robust. In the absence of auditory access for up to 12 years, or in the absence of language access for up to 3 years. So now we know that deaf children can detect patterns or regularities in their environment. And that's important because many deaf children don't have full access to a clear linguistic signal. For example, consider listening to spoken language using cochlear implants. there's still noise that the child has to sort through to figure out where the information is in that noisy signal. Or, for another example, consider learning a sign language from hearing parents who are not themselves skilled or fluent signers. You have the same issue there, where the child has to figure out where the information is within that noise. So for future research, it'll be important to figure out exactly how implicit learning contributes to the child's ability to filter through the signal and identify where the information is in the noise.